again, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Angles and Attitudes. He's John. John, how you doing?
How's it going, Mark?
Good. And today we are joined by the legendary voice of the Green Bay Packers. That's right, the Green Bay Packers, Wayne Larrivee. Wayne, thanks for joining us and welcome to the podcast.
Hey, Wayne.
Good to be with you, Mark and John. Good to be with you.
Well, I guess right now we got to ask, what do you fill your time with now that football season is not going on? You're not golfing.
I do a little college basketball, and I'm a skier, so I've got some ski trips that I've already taken and have planned coming up. So, you know, I keep busy until we get to golf.
There you go. Until we get to golf. That's what we're all hoping for. I know here we had just said that we're just about 30 miles outside of Chicago, and I think Sunday we got like almost 60, and it starts to tease you. And then this morning the wind chill was -2. So you kind of right, you pass your clubs in the garage and you wave at them and go, someday.
Yeah, exactly.
So we start for us, we're old hockey guys too. Your career kind of starts right in your own way in the Boston Garden, doing your own play-by-play and doing tapes. Kind of walk us through from there to here.
Yeah, well, you know, play-by-play is a type of thing. I mean, you've really got – it's repetition. It's like playing the game. You've got to get your reps to get any good at it. And so when I was in college at Emerson College, I used to go to the Boston Garden and would go up into the empty hockey boxes and broadcast Celtics games into my tape recorder and did that for every Celtics game I was in town for, and it was great. I even got in as a member of the media eventually. You know, I was there so often. So it really worked out well, gave me some repetition, and it allowed me to go back and listen to it and evaluate it and that type of thing and run it by some people in the business. You know, being in downtown Boston, we have a lot of people in the business that were there, and they were helpful, and eventually hooked on and got some jobs doing some high school games.
Wayne, I got to ask you, was a guy like Johnny Most or Fred Cusack, the old Boston Bruins announcer, were these guys that you kind of like said, wow, I want to try to emulate and be like them? Because here in Chicago, I used to do a thing where I would take a tape recorder in my bedroom after Lloyd Pettit would do the games, and I would have my own synopsis of the game. Being the homer that I was always defending the Blackhawks, of course. It was never their fault. It was, something that a freak accident that happened in the stadium. But was it guys like Most and Cusack that gave you this urge to do this?
No, you know, I grew up in Western Massachusetts near the New York border. Our cable TV was New York oriented. I became a big New York fan, a big New York Yankees fan, because my grandfather was a Yankees fan. And when cable TV was coming online, so was color TV. And my grandfather said to my dad, said, if you put in cable, I'll buy you a color TV. And so he did. And Grandpa Gigante came up to the house Thursday through Sunday, Thursday night, Friday night, all day Saturday and Sunday, and watched the Yankees and on our color TV. So I became more of a New York fan. The guy who influenced me for the most was Marv Albert, doing the great Knicks teams of the early 70s, who won 2 world championships. He was the best I've ever heard on radio doing basketball, and the best I've heard since. So he was really good when he was on radio, young guy, doing the New York Knicks in those great years.
Sure. He just recently retired, right? Like he's just ticked over 80 years old, right? And they had kind of reduced his schedule because he was still doing some TV stuff, TBS or TNT for the NBA, right?
Yeah, he just retired from TNT last year after last season, yeah.
Speaking of that just off again, did you catch any of the All-Star game in the ways that they're trying to package it now? The Shaq with Kenny the Jet and Ernie Johnson trying to referee with him and Charles Barkley trying to do a little bit of the Manning thing?
You know, I did NBA basketball in Chicago for 18 years. The one thing we never would do is watch the All-Star game. And so I continue that tradition today.
We were in a hockey tournament in a hotel in Pittsburgh, my son and I, and that was all that was on at the 9 o'clock Eastern time on Sunday night. It was that or the closing ceremonies of the Winter Olympics. So it was the lesser of two evils. It's interesting.
Very disappointing Winter Olympics, I might add.
Yes.
Right.
You talk about you know, your background in the East. And it's funny to even consider that because you've become so synonymous with the Bulls, with the Chiefs, with the Bears, with, you know, with the Packers and all. You work your way to Iowa, do some work in Iowa and kind of pick it up from there.
Well, you know, I was, when I was at Emerson College in Boston and doing all those games into my tape recorder, I was also working at a local radio station in Great Barrington, Massachusetts, on the weekends, just kind of spinning records and filling the time. It was a daytime station, so I would work Saturday afternoons and Sunday afternoons and then go back to college. So I was, basically, I would take some of my tapes that I felt were really good and I would apply to these blind ads in a publication called Broadcasting Magazine. And eventually I heard from, you know, somebody in Pampa, Texas, and they wanted me to come down and do high school football. I thought that would be pretty cool, but I was still in college. So I made kind of a deal with my parents and with the radio station that I would come down and do a football season in Pampa, Texas, which is a town of 25,000, just a little bit northwest of Amarillo. And I went down there and did Friday Night Lights for one semester out of college. And it was a great experience. And it was just wonderful. A town like, you know, back in 1975, 25,000, as I said, the two tallest structures in town were the grain elevators for the Jimmy Dean sausage plant and the press box of the football stadium. And every Friday night, 15,000 would show up to watch the Pampa Harvesters play in that stadium. So it was a great experience.
Was that KGRO, Wayne, when you were talking about Texas?
Yeah, KGRO in Pampa, Texas. Yep.
Yep.
Well, and then you find your way, you did baseball, basketball, and work your way eventually with the Kansas City Chiefs. And that's where, for us, we began to pick you up and hear your voice and recognize the voice when then, you know, I was talking to my wife, just, she's like, you know, who are you talking to today? And I said, you know, Wayne Larrivee. She goes, oh yeah, the Bears guy. So little by little, you worked your way into the Midwest and found your way behind the mic at Soldier Field for a rather memorable 1985 season.
Oh yeah, it was great. I got a great break out of college. I had, you know, I went back to school after the Texas experience and did some high school sports and football primarily. And so when I came out of college, when I graduated from college, I had a lot of commercial experience behind me and I got a great break. I got a job doing Iowa Hawkeyes football for KSTT radio in Davenport, Iowa. And it's an opportunity that doesn't exist today because back then in the 70s and early 80s, all these major schools like Big Ten schools, they didn't have one network doing their games. Iowa had 13 different originations of Iowa football. It was incredible. And so, you know, and maybe Wisconsin had two or three and most, you know, most Big Ten schools had multiple originations of their games. So I was hired to do news and do Iowa Hawkeyes football. And it was a great opportunity, great break. I'll never forget my second game doing Iowa football. We had a game against UCLA in the LA Coliseum. And because the press box wasn't big enough to accommodate 13 different originations, they put most of us up on the roof. So I could reach up and touch the lights. It was a night game. And here I was on the roof trying to do this football game. And I remember I got somebody wrong who scored a touchdown. Nobody knew, and I didn't know until I got back to Iowa and read about it in the newspaper and said, wait a minute, I got that guy wrong because I had the wrong number because I couldn't see from that far away. But it was a great experience. So the Kansas City Chiefs job opens up the next year. I'm about 23 years old. I send in one of my best Iowa tapes, and I get a form letter back 2 weeks later. And it's, you know, from KCMO Radio in Kansas City. And they said, thanks, but no thanks. So I kept the letter and everything. And then I looked in Broadcasting Magazine 2 months later, saw the same job open. So this time I called the guy whose name was on the bottom of the letter. And I said, would you mind if I reapplied? And he was kind of taken aback by that. And he said, yeah, go ahead. So I sent him exactly the same tape that I'd sent the first time. And I figured, well, it's the best stuff I've got. And knowing, you know, they may not, with my age, may not have even listened to what I sent them. So this time they listened, and then they called back and they asked for more tape and more tape. I probably sent them something from every game I did of Iowa that year. And this thing dragged on for 3 months. And it came down to trying to convince the Chiefs to hire this 23-year-old guy who was doing Iowa games. And the prerequisite on the whole thing was you had to be doing major college, minimum major college football or NFL football. So they had a lot of guys who wanted to come in and do the Chiefs and do just the games and leave. What the station wanted was to hire a guy who would come in and be part of the community. Well, eventually they convinced the Chiefs that this was the way to go, and they hired me, and I was there for 7 years, and it was a great experience. It really was. Met some wonderful people, some great people in the media that used to play touch football every Thursday. Guys like Rick Oslin, who went on to be a major writer in the National Football League, in the Hall of Fame now, in the NFL Hall of Fame, and Kevin Harlan, and so many guys. John Rooney, who does Cardinals baseball, and Rush Limbaugh was working for the Royals at the time as a sales guy, and he was part of our group on Thursdays that played touch football. It was a great experience. It really was. And then in 1985, I got a chance to do the Bears. And, you know, that was an eye-opener to come number one to Chicago and number two to catch that team of all teams.
Wayne, I got to ask you, I know, you know, you're doing the college, then doing, not to discredit the Kansas City Chiefs, but did you think that Chicago step, just because of what was here before, like when I say what was here before, Brickhouse and Cups in it, who did the games here for years, and then, of course, you know, the next step, was this like, okay, I'm coming from the Chiefs now to, you know, George Halas and the Chicago Bears. What was this for you? Was this a huge step in your mind?
Yes, it was. It was, you know, and a logical step in a broadcasting career to go from a Kansas City at the time to a Chicago. You know, and it was a great experience because I got in with the Tribune Corporation, WGN. And eventually I did all kinds of stuff for them. It was great. And it was the best 14 years of my broadcasting career because of all the different things I did. Now, to come in and do the Bears and follow Joe McConnell, the Bears games had been on WBBM after being on WGN for decades. They were, I think they spent 8 years on WBBM. And I remember listening to Joe McConnell. I still think he was one of the best radio play-by-play guys for football I've ever heard. And, you know, to get a chance to succeed him was, you know, a lot of pressure. No question about that. But it was a great opportunity. And I'll never forget Dan Fabian, who was the legendary program director at the time at WGN. And WGN, you have to understand, guys, at that time was the number one radio station, not just in Chicago, in the frickin' country. Okay. Nobody billed more. Nobody had more sports. Nobody had better quality talk shows that had higher ratings in the country than WGN. And nobody came close to billing the kind of money WGN did. Not New York, not LA, not Chicago, not San Francisco, not anyone. It was an unbelievable experience from the mid-80s to the mid-90s at WGN Radio. So Dan Fabian gets the games back, and here they are. They're putting a new broadcast team together on WGN. They hire me from Kansas City. Well, nobody in Chicago knows who I am. They bring me in to do the play-by-play. They hire Jim Hart, who had just retired as an NFL quarterback, most recently with the Cardinals, but well-known as the longtime quarterback and a Hall of Fame caliber quarterback with the Cardinals in St. Louis. The thing about Jim was he is a St. Charles native. So there was some logic in that, but Chicago didn't know Jim Hart, except that he was a Cardinals quarterback. So here's Fabian, he's sitting here, okay, I've got these two guys. I've got a play-by-play guy. I've got an analyst. How do I make this thing Chicago? Well, who's the quintessential Bear in 1985? Dick Butkus. Dick Butkus is an actor living in Malibu, California. And Dan Fabian calls him up, says, we want you to come in. All you have to do is come in and do the games. We don't need you to analyze anything, to go in depth on anything unless you want to. All we want you to do is when something good happens, you go, yeah. And when something bad happens, you growl or whatever. And Butkus, being an actor, said, well, yeah, I can do that. So he comes to the broadcast, and that made us Chicago.
Because he was just living sound effects. And it's interesting you talk about that, because football, 10 weeks out of the year or 8 weeks out of the year, that day takes on an entirely different meaning, right? You've called baseball, you've called one of 80 of NBA, you know, NBA games or whatever. There's another one tomorrow. We're back to back, whatever it is. But Sunday has everything that everybody does during those 8 to 10 weeks is all centered on football, right? You go to church at a certain time, you got to eat at a certain time, or you're going to tailgate at a certain time. The pressure, especially in Chicago, had to be immense. Like you said, WGN, right? We grew up on WGN. You got everything there. If school, you as a kid, you listened to GN hoping to hear school was closed. Sure. And if it wasn't, you know, then you had to listen to Wally Phillips. And then when, and you listen to the Cubs and all of that. So talk us around initially the whole Bear thing, when you start to put that team together and when you could feel it starting to gel for yourself, the three of you, you know, preseason games or game number three during the year or whatever, you went like, yep, we got it.
You know, it certainly took a while, but we had, and this is the thing, Mark, we had such a compelling team to follow. I got there in June. I remember being at some, I don't know, charity promotional thing at Soldier Field, and Ditko was there and a couple of the Bears players from that team. And I just remember a group of players. I've never seen a group like that was so locked in to winning that Super Bowl that year. And you know, the hardest thing with pro football, and it's much easier, I've seen it in basketball, you can repeat more easier in basketball. Why? Because really you're involving 15 players. Well, in pro football today, your roster is 53 men, and to get 53 people on the same page, and by the way, you need all 53, all right? To get them on the same page, to repeat, is to get them to do it once is a hard thing to do. So here was this collection of tremendous talent, but also I've never seen a group with so many alpha dogs in it. You know, usually there's one alpha dog, okay, in these championship teams. This team had about 10 of them. And they all had great talent. They all had tremendous personalities. They all had agendas. But after losing the previous year in San Francisco in the NFC title game, and by the way, they felt they should have won that game. And those of us on the outside of the NFL, I was in Kansas City at the time, we all sat there and said, you guys thought you should have, none of us thought you should be even better in that game, for God's sakes. How did Washington lose to you guys? You guys were in your first playoff run.
Right.
And they went beat Washington on the road. They went to San Francisco. They lost 20-3 and they were bitter. And that game molded them back together. That molded all these agendas, all this stuff together. I could sense that when I saw them in June. I could sense that at Platteville in the early weeks of July. I could sense that. I could feel that. And I've never seen a group so focused on doing one thing. And yet knowing that they had all of these personalities, all of these alpha dogs, all of these agendas, but for one season, they were focused on one goal and they could not be stopped. It was an amazing thing to see. So our broadcast kind of jumped on those coattails. The Bears were so compelling, it almost didn't matter what we said.
Wayne, I got to tell you, you said it right. From that loss to San Francisco, they took on the talk was right after that game that this was going to be the team to watch the following year. So that was a great memory and a reminder from you. Thank you.
Well, you have, you know, but a lot of those guys on defense, Otis Wilson, Hampton, Singletary, Dent, and you go on. And again, for us, because there's only been one in our lifetime, we can still rattle off probably the 11 on each side of the ball. You know, everybody else would just go, well, you know, Butler and McMahon and, you know, McKinnon and Sui and Thayer and all those guys. And we could probably do that. So they were that compelling that quickly they ingrained themselves into the minds of the fans. And then it was that living and breathing every Sunday. And that crescendo built where they just beat the snot out of people. And it wasn't even about winning anymore, right? It was how they were going to win the game.
Well, and they transcended the sport. I mean, they became a huge news item. They were on the national news for whatever they were doing. They were incredible, a brash group that put a hit record together, you know, the Super Bowl shuffle. And I'll tell you the side story of that. You might have heard it, but for those who haven't, I mean, the Bears lost one game that year. An incredible Monday night game, one of the highest rated Monday night games in the history of the entire series. It was a Monday night, late in the season. The Bears were undefeated. I believe they were 13-0, went to Miami to play Dan Marino and the Dolphins. And the Dolphins beat them that night. It was the biggest story of the NFL season at that time. And that set up what we were all hoping for, Bears, Dolphins, in Super Bowl 20. That's what we were all hoping for.
Yeah.
That game. But here are the Bears coming home from that game. They're only lost, bitter and disappointed. Well, you know when they shot the Super Bowl shuffle? The next morning in Chicago. They shot that video. Think about that.
That's some big onions.
They went through with that next morning. Well, Tuesday was their day off, and that's when they shot that video. And they had to drop because Walter Payton didn't make it, and a couple of other guys didn't. They had to drop those guys in. I think McMahon was another guy who didn't, but the rest of them were all there. Mm-hmm. And they shot that video after the only loss of their season.
And I remember a lot of people saying, I didn't know it was on their Tuesday, Wayne, what an arrogance. You know, we're already doing this dance like the 69 Cubs. Hey, hey, holy mackerel. We're already doing this dance.
And, you know, here's another to speak about. You used the right word. Dan Hampton was not in that video, if I'm not mistaken. And Dan said he turned them down. He said, no, we got to win something first before we do something like that. That was his mantra. But so he wasn't in that video, as far as I remember.
No, and that was very much him. You know, you don't talk about it, you do it. Yep. And he, to this day, is, unfortunately, with the way the Bears have been going lately, the post game is much more entertaining than the game. And you listen to Hamp and OB back on WGN, which is even more interesting based on the fact that WBBM has the game. But from an entertainment standpoint, Hamp and OB are where you want, because OB to this day, you know, you're afraid he's going to have a heart attack at some point in time during the game, you know, during the post game when, you know, John from Elk Grove calls and pisses OB off and he's coming through the radio at him, talking to him about, you know, Papa Bear and running into the wall at Wrigley Field in those days. So that's unfortunately the state of the Bears right now. But back to that Super Bowl year, were there people that, you know, came to interview you as part of that to ask questions where you're just kind of like, why do you want to talk to me? I just get to watch these guys. Any stories around the Super Bowl in that regard?
Yeah, I mean, as we got closer to the Super Bowl, there were interviews like that, but not a lot because, you know, we were so new. And I remember this, and the one thought I had on the whole season was, I wish I had been there the 10 previous years, you know what I mean? Had seen the buildup to this thing, because I come in from Kansas City, okay? Now, the Chiefs were not what they are today, okay? Kansas City is a one-horse town. At that time, in the 70s, the Royals, in the 80s, the Royals were the big team, all right? The Chiefs were nothing. The Chiefs couldn't sell out Arrowhead Stadium except for the Raiders and the Broncos. Aside from that, Arrowhead Stadium, you can get a ticket on day of the game and a good seat as well. So it wasn't the big deal. It was Marv Levy building a football team, starting from the ground floor up. The best year they had when I was in Kansas City was, they went 9-7 and lost six of their last eight games to get there. So then Marv got fired. Makovic comes in. It gets, you know, you take, bring in a new coach in those days, take six steps back to make two steps forward, and it wasn't going very well. So anyway, I come to Chicago. I hadn't seen a team, the team I broadcast for, I hadn't seen a team win like this. So I said to myself, gosh, I wish I had a little more appreciation for the buildup to this, to what people were feeling. And you're exactly right. There was tremendous, I can't remember which one of you guys said, talked about the Cubs. You know, you don't want to go make a song before you win something like
that. Yeah, holy mackerel, yeah.
Well, you know, let me tell you something. All people could think about on the run by the Bears into December, heading toward the playoffs, was all they could think about was, oh, my God, somehow, some way, these guys are going to mess this thing up. Somehow, this can't be true. It's not going to happen. There was a tremendous amount of doubt and trepidation in the fandom. Now, they won't admit to it today, but I can tell you, I felt that from the fandom at that time.
Mark and Wayne, I got to tell you one thing about that Super Bowl game. Let's see if you both remember this. Tony Eason had started the game for New England, and Walter got a draw pass from McMahon. He fumbles it, and they hit a field goal. And I turned to everybody. I was at a Super Bowl party, and I go, I hope it's not time to do the fumbling shuffle because Walter had fumbled. Yeah. And I'm like, oh, boy, hear what you had just said now was playing in my mind.
Yep. Here goes that. Yeah, here we go again. Yep. And obviously it didn't. And then, unfortunately, that team never got to achieve what. And that's a Chicago sports malady, right? Even when they win, it's not enough winning. The Bears, obviously, things happen, injuries, you know, Doug Flutie, Ditka, and some of that, you know, just irrational behaviors or the irregularities that we all, unfortunately, as Bear fans, came to expect. And sure enough, it starts to happen. And over the next few years, it kind of unravels.
Well, you know, it's interesting because remember what I was talking about a few minutes ago about what bound that team together. Well, the Super Bowl basically broke the bound, okay? All of a sudden, now it's everybody, and it was a whole different mentality. It was everybody for themselves. And, you know, they tried to focus and all this other stuff, but what had bound them together, that common goal, now was accomplished. So now what do you do? Well, you think you're going to go win another one. And we all thought they were going to win two or three more. Easily. They were the youngest team in the NFL in 1985. Of course, they're going to win more Super Bowls. Maybe not in a row, but they're going to win more Super Bowls. They're just the best team in the league. And they were for the next 3 years after that. Best, most talented team. But they weren't the best team because what had bound them together and made them the best team now was gone. That goal was gone and the agendas were different. So I remember this was like, the following season, I think they were playing the Packers. It might have been the game where McMahon got injured. Charles Martin made that hit. It might have been that game. And, I remember coming back, and the Bears had been winning. They won like four. They went 14-2, I want to say, that follow-up season. But they weren't the same. And I remember saying at that point, I said, you know what? The Bears aren't going to win the Super Bowl. But I certainly didn't expect them to lose in the divisional round of the playoffs at home to a Washington Redskins team that I felt, and again, they were the Redskins at the time. I know they're the Commanders today. But you know, that Washington team that I thought was not nearly as good as Chicago.
No way.
But here's the other thing. Not only did they lose that year, they lost the following year to the same team.
Washington.
And, you know, that's where things really unraveled. But and I got to tell you this, another thing about I remember about that group, all those players, a lot of those players I became friends with, many of whom I've shared broadcast booths with. You know, the glory of the Super Bowl cannot overshadow the feel and the loss of not repeating a Super Bowl, not getting back there and winning another Super Bowl. That disappointment far outweighs the glory of that one Super Bowl. And that tells you something about athletes in general, okay? Athletes will tell you more about the games they lost than the games they won, because the loss stings a lot more than the victory savors for them. And that's really, I've found that with high-level athletes in all the sports I've covered, okay? You don't get over the loss, okay? The win, yeah, you celebrate the win, but then you're on to the next challenge of repeating that win. I'll never forget Phil Jackson in the middle of the Bulls run. And I said to him, you know, we were at a get together, the Bulls sponsored ahead. And I said to him, you know, happened to be sitting at the table, said, Phil, how long do you let it all soak in after winning a championship? He said about, 3 or 4 hours. And then I started thinking about, what do we have to do to win the next one?
Yeah.
You're the top dog. People are coming after you right away. Yep. They're preparing to come after you again. Yes.
And you don't want anybody to believe that was a fluke, because you can argue, right? Everybody can win one. A ball bounces, a referee call, something that lays on the rim and falls off instead of falls in, and then you're on to the next round and you can't repeat it. And like you said, Wayne, coaches talk about that all the time, right? Give me the guy who hurts a lot more for losing than he feels good for winning. And those are the guys that I want to take on my team. And I'm going to build a consistent winner with those guys because of that fact, more so than the guys that, you know, just enjoy the win there. So, and we saw that, and unfortunately now we're big hockey fans. So we were fortunate to watch, from our standpoint, for one of your brethren, a guy like Pat Foley, had to put up with some really not good Blackhawk teams, you know, where Pat could pretty much broadcast to the individuals in the stands because there were 3,000 people, you know. Or, you know, Adrian Acoin once said when he was on the ice, he could actually tell his kids to do their homework while they were in the stands because it was so quiet. But they could work their way, you know, Foley could work his way up to 10 to 13 and 15 and really appreciate and enjoy those wins because he knew where it once was compared to where they were on top of the mountain at that point, right?
Absolutely. I think that's such a great point you're making. You know, when Mark, when you're around something, it's like, you know, the Packers Super Bowl. I had been with the team for 10 years or more. And when they won Super Bowl, 45, I had an appreciation. I had a historical appreciation for where it all had come from and how it had come about. I didn't have that, unfortunately, with the 85 Bears. I just had a great appreciation for what I was seeing.
Mark, Wayne, I want to ask you, being in Chicago all those years, was you had the Bears, you had the Bulls, you did the Cubs, you had shows, you were with Arkish, you did a lot of things. Was there, even though we were talking a lot here more about the Bears, was there that one favorite thing where he says, wow, I love really doing this here in Chicago? Or, you know, I mean, you were the main guy here from 84 to 98.
Yeah, you know, I really enjoyed doing the Bulls. That was great because, you know, the NBA was different back then. It was a great product back then. It really was. I don't think it's nearly as good a product today. And, you know, that's part of the reason why they do all that, all the machinations around the All-Star game and everything else. It's just not the same. But it was a great product. And I was there for five of the six championships with the Bulls. And that to me was a high point. But the most fun, the best thing I've ever done is NFL football on the radio on Sundays. That's really the thing I enjoy doing the most on radio. TV is a different animal, different ball game. It's the ultimate team sport and broadcast because you've got a producer, you've got a director, you've got camera people, you have a picture that you have to talk to. And, you know, it's a much tougher deal for a play-by-play guy because you're such a conduit. You're not describing, you're not painting a picture. You're basically framing a picture. You're getting a telecast to a commercial break or to a feature, or you're trying to just put a word on something you just saw. Chandelier jam or the dagger of the shot that ended the ball game, that kind of thing. Whereas in radio, you are the picture. You're painting that picture and you have full control over that. You don't have to worry about what the director is showing you, okay? You don't have to talk about that because he may be showing you something that doesn't interest you at the time. And yet as a radio person, you can describe, you are basically setting the page, setting the picture for what the listener is going to visualize. So I think NFL football on Sundays is what I've enjoyed doing most. But the highlight was, of course, those Bulls teams on WGN TV.
But that Sunday noon kickoff is Americana. And I appreciate, and I got kind of chills because even like, again, the hockey thing, a guy like Mike Emmerich is a radio broadcaster on TV because he was able to, he painted that picture, you know, he ladled the puck out, he waffle boarded it. And even though you're watching, your mind has that picture of, yeah, the waffle board or the ladle as he moves the puck out. And your imagery calling those games on Sunday through the radio because you're the people in Green Bay, in Oshkosh, in Sheboygan, you're their eyes for that moment if they're ice fishing or they're in a boat or whatever it is. And to that point, and John, you're going to have to indulge me. through part of my jobs, I spent years calling in Wisconsin. And I think the whole Green Bay experience gets a bad rap because people in Chicago have an arrogance like they know more about football. Can you talk a little bit, Wayne, about, because you get washed in it. You can be there for 20 minutes, literally on Lombardi Way, and go, wow, I understand it a little bit better. Or when it was there, I went to, you know, Brett Favre's steakhouse or whatever it is. Can you kind of share with everybody else what that was like the first time you went and were like, hey, we're not in Kansas or Chicago anymore?
You know, it's interesting because as a kid in the 60s, I grew up a Green Bay Packers fan. You know, the color TV, the Packers, the NFL was bursting on the scene, and it was Lombardi's Packers and that whole bit. And I followed that very closely as a kid back in Massachusetts. So I'd always had these thoughts about, you know, what was it like at Lambeau Field and all this other stuff and watching the NFL film stuff and everything. I come to Kansas City, it's 1978. It's my first year. It's Marv Levy's first year. And our first preseason game is a game in Green Bay against the Packers. And I talked to James Lofton, has become at times a broadcast partner of mine and a good friend. And it was his first year too in 1978. He was the Packers' first round draft choice. So I tell him, you know, we often talk about that game, that preseason game. I'll never forget walking into Lambeau Field. This is before skyboxes. This is when the two scoreboards were the Pabst scoreboard, one on the south side of the stadium, one on the north end of the stadium. It was Lambeau Field pretty much the way Lombardi left it. And it was a tremendous experience for me. It was almost a holy experience for me to do that preseason game. I was so jacked up to be in that stadium. And you're right. It's a much different experience. Even today, with all the building that's going on around there, it's still a unique experience in the NFL.
I've never had the pleasure of attending a game. We've done the tours after they changed out the stadium, and one of my customers is literally right down the street. So to go visit, you'd have to drive back and forth. And I'd always be late for my appointments because I would just kind of go slowly and drive around and look at other things. And now I find myself with the aerial shots, trying to remember what was or wasn't there outside as the buildup continued on the west side and those types of things. But and I have to admit, you know, one of those things, we took the tour and they put you in the tunnel and the music and the crowd noise starts. And all of a sudden that door comes up and you're like, let's go. And you're like, I feel, you know, like I'm cheating on my hometown Bears. But for that moment, the hair stands up on your arms and you're ready to take the field. And that's something that I don't think, unless you're there, Bear fans want to, you know, downgrade that. But it's when you're there, you get a much better understanding of what that's all about and the love and the genuine love for the team that may not always be the case with the Bears.
Yeah, it's interesting. But, you know, and I found both fan bases to be extremely knowledgeable. And the fan bases are hard on their teams. And probably because they do know a lot about football, both fan bases. And so they expect a lot and they're hoping for a lot. And I think that's really the thing that's maybe a little bit different. The hope is a little deeper in Green Bay for the Packers, their fans. In Chicago, it's become, you know, I think that sometimes hope is lost a little bit, but hey, the fan bases are wonderful. They're great. They're very similar in that they can be critical of their team, but somebody from the outside comes in and start criticizing their team. Well, that person's the enemy. So
right, because you've done,
if you're not a best fan base, you better not be saying anything wrong about my team.
Because you've done both. I mean, Bears, Packers, you're doing it on the professional level. You are the outsider looking in. You really must truly see that rivalry.
Oh yeah. I think it's great. And it varies with the teams from the standpoint of for the Packers for many years, the Vikings became a little bit bigger rival than the Bears, you know, and that type of thing. But when Lovie Smith had the Bears going to the Super Bowl and that type of thing, it rekindled this, you know, if on the field, the rivalry wavered a little bit. It never did in the stands, okay? It never did with the fans of either team, okay? That's never, that rivalry has never waned. I will say this, it does wane a little bit maybe in the locker rooms of these two teams at times. But when Lovie Smith, who did a great job with the Bears, they took two steps back to go one step forward when they fired him, and they haven't, they've now taken four steps back. So, you know, I will say this, when it was so appropriate, it was so wonderful to see the Bears and Packers in that NFC title game in 2010. That, for those of us who understand the rivalry, were a part of the rivalry, especially those of us who have seen it both ways, that was a magical moment in Soldier Field that day.
Well, those are the things that I think are missing now in a lot of sports, the tradition. You know, like I said, when I was exposed more on a regular basis, dug a lot more in NFL films to watch the, you know, a life in the game in the Lombardi or Horning or, you know, Forrest Gregg or Brett Favre and a lot of those life in football, to dig even deeper to understand. And then being around town every once in a while, that whole thing comes together and it's a really, just for lack of a better term, it's a really neat experience. But when you were talking about earlier about hope, I think one of the differences, the culture, the people in Wisconsin, it's okay to hope. Sometimes in Chicago, people get too cool and they can't be, you can't invest too much because it's just not cool, where Packer fans are just like, hey, we live and breathe this and we're okay with that. And we'll own it, where sometimes I think Chicago fans kind of like, we don't want to maybe go. We do, but we don't want to show it.
Right. You know, it's interesting because I think there is this aspect of the community factor involved with the Packers that's a little different. I mean, I understand that the stock certificate cannot be bought or sold on the market and everything else. And it has no monetary value per se. However, I think it has tremendous value in terms of spiritual value to the people who own the piece of paper. And I think it's a very important aspect of how Packers fans look at their football team. It is community owned and they take pride in that. And many of them do technically own the football team, even though they cannot cash that piece of paper for money, for monetary gain.
Right. That's a great point by you.
Take us through a Sunday at Lambeau. What time do you get there? Going through your prep with your partner? How do you, I'm sure in listening to your broadcast, they're energetic, they're wonderful. And I almost want to, at times during this podcast, want to close my eyes and just listen to you as if you're on the radio again, because the voice brings back so many memories. But take us through that as you kind of work your way, get to Lambeau and get yourself ready for 11:59 and the kickoff at noon. I see the smile.
I live in just north of Milwaukee. I'm 90 minutes door to door from my house to Lambeau Field. So usually on a Sunday, if I'm not up there the Saturday before for something and staying overnight, usually on Sunday, I'll head up. Let's say it's a noon game. I'll leave here about 8:30 and head up. I stop at Quick Trip for the Breakfast of Champions, a 24-ounce cup of coffee and a cream-filled Long John. And
they're done that.
Breakfast of Champions.
You got it.
Not quite what my idols Mickey Mantle and Whitey Ford would call Breakfast of Champions, but you know, when you probably
Don't go there, Wayne.
Win in Rome, right? Win in Rome. Yeah. If you tell me you get the chicken sandwich on the way home to top it off, that I know for sure.
No, you know, so I get up there about 9 o'clock for a noon game. And usually we go on the air, it's top of the pregame show, which is 2 hours before game time, so around 10. And then, you know, in the past, for the most part, not this latest regime, but I would interview the coach 90 minutes. Mike McCarthy and I would sit down and talk that pregame interview 90 minutes before kickoff, and then go back upstairs, have a little lunch, and then we'd hit the airwaves following that interview I had with the head coach and get into it from there. Larry McCarron and I do very little pregame talking together. We both prepare, but we don't compare notes necessarily. And it's just a little different in that regard. It's always been that way. Now, Larry kind of prefers that because then what we talk about on the air is more spontaneous. And it just works out fine. Usually we see each other at practice on Thursdays, but, you know, the game kicks off at noon and we go on. Post game, he goes down to the locker room and I do a post game show around the highlights. And then that's it. Then I head down, get a pop and head home. So it's a long day, but it's a great day to be at a game in Green Bay. And it doesn't get old, and it hasn't over 23 years.
Wayne, I got to ask you a question. When you went to Green Bay and that first game against the Bears, was it weird? Meaning, okay, here I was doing the Bears. Now I'm the voice of the Packers. Did you have butterflies after all the years of experience?
Well, it was a very emotional time because that previous Monday, the Packers had played Seattle at home and lost on a Monday night. And that day, Walter Payton died. And so there was a lot of emotion that went into that whole week for any of us who knew Walter. And for the Bears especially. And I remember my old broadcast partner, Dan Hampton, kind of emceed a remembrance for Walter at Soldier Field the day before. I remember seeing that. It was tremendously emotional for all of us. And so the Bears come up that Sunday. And it was a back and forth game. And remember, I had the Wanstead Bears had lost about, I don't know, 8 in a row, I think it was, to the Packers prior to that season. And so meanwhile, the Bears win on a field goal in the final seconds. And at that time, the broadcast positions for the home radio and the visiting radio were right next to each other. And my old statistician, Doug Coletti, reaches over the window, hands me a note. You've now lost 9 in a row in the Bears. So that's kind of how
the way.
Everybody used to talk about the influence of Walter Payton on the field goal and all of those things wrapping around that. I do recall that. Switching gears to, you know, you've also been privy to quarterback play in consistent back-to-back years that no one, right? I mean, as a Bear fan talking to a Packer fan, can't even relate to not having a quarterback who will end up in the Hall, who either is in the Hall of Fame or will end up in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, it's been an amazing run when you think of it. Montana and Steve Young had a great run in San Francisco back-to-back, but not nearly this long. This is 30 years now, basically, of Brett Favre and Aaron Rodgers. And the thing about it, and people complain around here about the fact, well, they've only won one Super Bowl, only gotten to three. But they've been relevant every year. They've made the playoffs year after year. They've had opportunities. And yeah, they didn't quite get it done, except for a couple of occasions. But nonetheless, I'd rather have that than go through what the Bears have been going through since Jim McMahon. And, you know, it's unfortunate with Jim. He was, a great player. Not necessarily a great quarterback, a great player, a great leader, and a guy who could have really made a difference had he been able to stay healthy with that football team. And he was perfect for the Bears, okay? He wasn't Marino. He wasn't Montana. But he was perfect for what the Bears needed at that time. He was a blood and guts leader. And I'm convinced they would have won more Super Bowls had he been able to stay healthy. But that wasn't the case. And they've had a bunch of quarterbacks since then, where the Packers have had basically two since Favre started. And I will say this, it certainly helps to have a franchise quarterback, but it is not a pretense to Super Bowl. It just isn't. You need a lot of other people and a lot of other things going well for you. It certainly helps, but Trent Dilfer's won a Super Bowl. Okay. There are a lot of
Flacco's won a Super Bowl,
pedestrian,
right?
Won Super Bowls. But the fact is, if you have one of those guys, you've got a better chance than anyone else. But on any given Sunday, who knows?
Well, that's the interesting and the irony of the Bears, right? Their third string quarterback this year was a Super Bowl MVP in Nick Foles, who couldn't find the field. Yeah. And they ended up going whatever it was, 7-11.
He's 1-0 this year.
you know, to figure that one out. But I think to your point, I mean, we have to watch Packer games because they're always on in the primetime slots because they win, right? You sit and at halftime, the 12 o'clock Bears game is over. So now you're flicking going, well, what's the 4 o'clock? And if you're watching TV on Fox, where's Troy Aikman and Joe Buck going to be? And it's Packers Rams, or it's, you know, Chris Collinsworth and Al Michaels on Sunday night. And your fandom also got, you know, Kohler to build everything around that stadium doesn't get built if you're going, you know, 6-10 in 1 year or 3 years in a row and then winning and then going back to 6-10, right? So there's a lot of economic benefit that guys like 4 and 12 have provided for that area.
Well, you know, it's funny. The new Yankee Stadium is the house that Derek Jeter built. The old Yankee Stadium is the house that Ruth built. The revitalization, the rebuild of Lambeau Field was done by Brett Favre. And the title town district, that's Aaron Rodgers. And you're right. I don't know how much of that happens if Ron Wolf and Mike Holmgren don't bring Brett Favre and Reggie White to Green Bay. You know what I mean? Does much of that happen? I guess some of it might, but probably not like it has happened over these last 30 years. So you're exactly right. I mean, there is a, especially in a smaller market like Green Bay out in Wisconsin. That's star power. Those wins year after year make a huge difference in where the franchise is right now.
Well, and that's amazing to think about those star power guys living in the hamlet that is Green Bay, right? I mean, you're looking at that going, well, LA and Chicago and New York and the club scene or whatever. And, you know, Clay Matthews can't walk through the Shopko to do his shopping at Tuesday afternoon because he's going to get mobbed, right? Or he's got to send somebody to go shopping for him because everybody knows everybody on that roster.
Yeah, that's both a blessing and a curse in some ways. As you mentioned, for the Stars, they would have trouble, you know, moving around. But I will say this, and most of the players have told me this, some of the star players as well, that the one thing about Green Bay, the people kind of leave you alone a little bit, you know. You don't have quite the rush. I know in Chicago, Michael Jordan couldn't go anywhere because, you know, there would be such a stir that he would create. Some of the Bears in 85, while they reveled in a lot of it, you know, there were times when you just like to be a normal person and you really can't in some of those hotbeds. But in Green Bay, people do respect the players and they're used to having them around. So it's not as big a deal as you might think. But I will say this, and I've interviewed a lot of the ex-Packers for a series I do for Packers.com, in that, you know, of all the places to play, playing for the Packers, playing in Green Bay, where what you do for a living is the number one thing, that certainly is a blessing. And they've enjoyed playing for this franchise in that regard.
It's come a long way since the Lombardi days of where the hell is Green Bay on the map? When you look at an old documentary of Lombardi, well, you know, just this is what it's amazing for sure.
But it's a testament to the skill set and how good a guy like Aaron Rodgers is, that he has the national presence that he has to have a bad haircut and still sell insurance and do all of those other things for a guy who's the quarterback in a city of a little bit over 100,000 people. That's just one of those, when you start to unravel that, you're like, that's star power.
You know, I wonder how much of that is media today. Mm-hmm. And that if you're a star player, you know, Josh Allen up in Buffalo or wherever you're a star, because of the platform that is media and the way the games are distributed today. And you go back to the 60s and those Lombardi Packers, they were nationally known. I mean, Jerry Kramer and Bart Starr and Paul Hornung and all those guys. And we didn't have the media back then that we have today. We had basically three television stations. One of them was CBS, and the Packers played the feature game all those years nationally. It seemed like every week they were on national TV on that CBS station, and they became a national story. But today, I think, you know, From a commercial standpoint, would you like to play in a big market? I guess. But today with media, the way it is, especially social media, sure, you don't have to, because almost everything you do is national.
And you look at, right, the two of them, the quarterback, Patrick Mahomes, Kansas City, not LA, again, not right, Chicago, any of that other stuff. You got two from relatively small markets with great history associated with the franchises over the course of time, but you got two guys from what would be considered normally relatively unknown, but they fit the market segment and their personalities and all of that stuff there. So,
yep, absolutely.
Hey, over under, we've been at almost 54 minutes and there's been no mention of the dagger. I got to let you explain that to us. I know the t-shirts and all, and you know, we had Pat Foley on a while back, or not Pat Foley, but Murray Bannerman, and we wouldn't have done justice to do the Pat Foley Bannerman call. So we were not going to in any way, shape or form attempt the dagger. Give us a little background on the dagger, if you will.
Well, you know, it's an NBA term. It's a basketball term. And we used to use it with the Bulls, you know, and I remember I was, you know, if Jordan, let's say, hits a 3-point shot that puts them up by two possessions and they're 5 seconds, 6 seconds to go, that's the dagger. That's NBA. And I remember I was doing, this is back in 2000, I was doing an NBA game in Chicago the night before, and I came up to Green Bay for a game that Sunday. The Packers are playing the Baltimore Ravens, and it was a back and forth game, and the Ravens were the defending champs. So it was a big game, and Brett Favre and the Packers are up by two scores, and it's midway through the fourth quarter, and Favre hits Bubba Franks on a touchdown pass in the south end zone of Lambeau Field. And it must have been just something subconsciously from the night before, that basketball term blurted out. I said, they scored. It was now a 3-score game. And I said, and there is your dagger. Yeah. And it took off from there. And then when I didn't use it a week later or whatever, people kept saying, well, when did you throw the dagger in this game?
See?
Well, so it's an old basketball term that that has become a football term. And I kind of throw it in when I feel like the game is over.
And that would, for me, trying to hear WTMJ from Chicago, when we hear dagger, unfortunately, your ratings go down. Yeah. That's mic drop. As soon as you go, and there's your dagger, we're the going dagger, back to yeah, the other station, and we're not going to hear you and Larry on the post game, because Wayne has said the dagger. And according to our research, you've only lost one dagger, and that was a controversial
right, yeah,
Seattle Seahawk game. So yeah, we're going to say that for that purpose, your record is still intact.
Yeah, a couple of them almost came out with the Bears.
So, well, we're going to go to, I'm going to give John the dagger. John's the goalie, and he has the, he gets to ask the last question. We've had a blast talking to you, Wayne. We appreciate your time. So, John, I'm going to turn the mic back over to you.
Thanks, Mark. Wayne, I got to tell you, growing up in Chicago, many great announcers. I do want to show you something real quick. I do have a 1966 mural of the Green Bay Packers with Lombardi and Adderley and Nitschke and Wood, all those guys, Jimmy Taylor. So this is the only thing in my trophy collection of the great Green Bay Packers, because I was a big Lombardi fan. But to sure, go back to you for a second, seen many great announcers in Chicago. I pick out three that I feel, even though, I mean, no one's going to, I'll be the judge and the jury, but there were three in Chicago that really loved their teams. Only three. I'm not going to mention Harry Carey, because Harry Carey loved the St. Louis Cardinals, but Jack Brickhouse truly loved the Chicago Cubs in the way he announced. Lloyd Pettit,
yeah,
truly loved the Chicago Blackhawks when he announced. And in my opinion, when I would listen to Wayne Larrivee do a Chicago Bear game, I felt you loved and had a passion for them like no other. So that is my dagger for this evening. Wayne, I really thank you for coming on here. I know I've been chasing you for a couple months, and this was truly probably one of the best podcasts we've had. I don't know how to, Mark and I don't know how to thank you. This was tremendous tonight.
Well, John and Mark, thank you so much for having me on. I've enjoyed it. I can't believe we spent that much time yakking at each other, but
it
just flew by. It just flew by for me. It's wonderful to talk to you. Chicago was a great portion of my career. As I said, 14 of the best years of my life, and enjoyed it greatly. It was great and an honor to be a part of those teams with the Bears and with certainly the Bulls and even the Sammy Sosa, Mark McGwire home run race when I was filling in for Harry doing Cubs games.
I remember a couple of those games with you.
Those were great. Those were great moments. And Chicago is the best sports town of the best sports people in the world.
Well, thanks for joining us. Stay well. And we look forward to good times on the slopes and on the course. And we'll look forward to August when football starts up again and being able to hear you on WTMJ.
Well, and let's hook up again someday down the road on this program.
For sure. Let's do it, Wayne.
You got it. Thanks, Wayne.
Take care, guys.
Thank you.
Be good.
Thank you.